Manodharma itself is a very interesting word. This morning we had a discussion on multiple things, including dissent. And there was this whole, the issue of the national anthem actually came up. And the national anthem is, I'm going to start there, because the most important word in the national anthem is the word that we don't notice. And that's the word manas. We think of everything else. We think of all the geographical locations that it mentions, Bangla or coming down the south, Dravida. But you don't realize that the most important word in the national anthem is manas, which is your mind and your heart and your being. And the hope is that this is a land of sharing minds and hearts. And Manodharma is not very different. It has two parts. It has the manas and it has dharma, which I think is one of the most beautiful words to have been discovered, maybe thought of, in the subcontinent. Dharma does not have an equivalent in the English language. We really don't know how to express it. You could probably call it ethical righteousness at some level. But I think the ethical is more important. And so dharma, or dhamma as the Buddha called it, not dharma but dhamma, is within frameworks of being, finding that which is ethical. And Manodharma is the seeking of the mind of that ethical within a certain being. And only difference here is we are here talking about a certain musical idea. So philosophically, Manodharma is not alien to any of us as human beings. We all seek ways of creativity, imagination in the way we live, in the frameworks that are given, and within that we are trying to find our way of touching upon that beautiful ethical being. So there is, you know, one of the words we use for Manodharma, we use a lot in Indian music, is improv or improvisation. In the academic circles, this is a point of great debate. Most academicians believe that's not the word we should be using, because improv has a very different connotation on how it operates compared to what we do in music, whether it is khayal or whether it is Carnatic music. The way it operates is very different. Some people like to call our Manodharma reorganization. So another thing I want to tell you is, musicians told you that we think of things like that and we are magicians who have this great thing that just falls when we sit in front of you. That's also a lie. Don't believe it. It's not just something that is falling out of the skies and we are these special beings who float 7 feet above the earth, who suddenly have that touch to touch this magical. No, the magical is there, but it's a little different. I'll come to that. So there's a complex set of things happening when this notion of imagination or creativity, another word I'm using, is in operation within a framework of music. There is memory. There is learning. There is knowing. There is reorganization. That too. And then there is this possibility of something surprising you. I'm talking about myself. So it's a combination of all these different things that come up with this notion of, wow, that was something incredible. The other word we love to say is we doing something new. It's also an inquiry of what do we mean by new? Do we mean that that's never been heard before? Do we mean that no other musician has conceived of this idea that I came up with? Or do we mean it felt new? It could be any of this and none of this. So this is just a preamble I'm giving you to the vagaries of the notion of Manodharma. In Carnatic music, there is definitely this notion north of the Vindhyas that Carnatic music does not have creative spheres, even though it is very limited. And there are two reasons, I think, why people, including Hindustani practitioners, who may have sung 100 Jugalbandis with 100 Carnatic musicians, still have no clue what Manodharma and Carnatic music is. I'm happy to state this in any gathering, anywhere. And the reason is I think in a very simplistic level, it has two reasons for it. One is the idea of speed. The notion that something slow is a gradual creative process. Is it or not is something we can discuss and debate. The second one, which I can also point out to, is the, shall we say, the obviousness of structure that is seen. And actually, when you're seeing obviousness of structure, what you're actually seeing is rhythmic structure. Now, the obviousness of the rhythmic structure, as framed by myself, her, and my colleagues on stage, gives you a notion of fixity. That everything is like nailed, and we are like struggling within that nail somehow, and somehow peep out a little bit of some creativity. Again, let's think a little deeper about it. Let's not accept that so easily. Because is this structure, first of all, nailed? Second, is it really claustrophobic for us sitting there? The third reason, which I'll add to the two I mentioned, is also the idea that we sing a lot of compositions. So the bandish is just one or two lines. But a kirtana or a composition that you hear in a Carnatic music concert is a complex being by itself. A composition itself, just rendition of a composition, can be anywhere between 4 minutes, and I can say there are big ones which are about 20 minutes. The composition itself, I've done nothing to it. So within that, is there a possibility even of creativity? So I think these are the many reasons why that there is a feeling that creatively Carnatic music is a lesser cousin. And I'm going to say all this is entirely wrong, because you're viewing an aesthetic from an already preconceived notion of an aesthetic. I will tell you the misunderstanding of Hindustani music in Carnatic world, to give you the other side of the coin also. You speak to Carnatic musicians, they'll tell you one simple thing. Hindustani music, there's only one good quality that we like. They all keep the tanpuras very well and sing in pitch. I'm telling you, most Carnatic musicians really feel that. Yes or no? Yeah. Second is, their rhythmic structure is what we will say in Tamil. I'll say it first in Tamil. Vada vada korokada. Now, what that actually means, it's like an old banana, which is like black. You know how gooey it is? That's what we are talking about. So we believe your rhythmic structure is just like that. That, you know, you have no form. You just get away with just, you know, not even keeping to basic rhythmic structures. Liberties are not taken. I mean, liberties are taken too much, right? I'm giving you all the preconceived notions. Then about raga music. We say, oh, very simple Hindustani music. You add one extra note to one raga and call it Mishra something. I'm just presenting to you the very well-framed, supposedly intellectual arguments that musicians on both the sides of the Vindhyas actually use against each other. And you can see now actually how frivolous both are. You laughed more for the latter because you know Hindustani music more. If I had made exactly the same comments in a Carnatic audience, they would have laughed for the former far more. So, You just understand we're all coming with this baggage. We're all coming with this baggage we're holding. And so the hope here is to maybe move you away from the heavy load that you're carrying about yourself and your own sense of aesthetics. And maybe try and enter what is happening here actually. So I'm going to try and go through the three or four different ways that we improvise. And as I've not planned anything, it's pretty free-flowing, and we'd love to be interrupted at any point of time. And any level of questions, students, listeners, people who have no clue. And let's see how it goes. I want to start with the composition itself. Okay, let me first sing a small composition. So then we will kind of play around with it. The name of the raga is Hari Kamboji. The composition of Tyagaraja. The tala is Rupaka tala, not the same as the Rupaka of the Hindustani tradition. This is, in physicality, a 3-beat cycle, in form, a 6-beat cycle.
Yeah.
Now is present a composition of Tyagaraja. So I'm going to just talk about two elements. I mean, there are many elements you can bring about. Just talk about two elements about the idea of the composition. First of all, how do we learn the compositions? All of us learn the compositions from our guru, our teacher. And the form is handed down by the guru, which has been handed down by her or his guru. There are two, three things we should remember about the whole notion of the oral tradition. The first very important aspect of the oral tradition, the fact that we just learned by listening, is I think this incredible understanding that the mind is never static. Anything that you've understood or grasped today is marinating in your head through your life. Every time you access that memory has been enriched by so many more experiences, so many more sounds, and so many more understandings. So the first question is, if I learn a composition 10 years ago and I sing it today, is it the same composition? Well, the answer is pretty obvious. It is not the same composition, because your mind is already building on those sounds that is you'll be handed over by a guru. So you may sing structurally like the way your guru gave it to you, but musically you're not singing like the way your guru gave it to you. So even those who believe they are perfectly following what the guru gave are actually contributing to that composition every time they sing it, every time they share it. So a composition is growing every time it's handed over to people. When it's handed over to the next generation, it starts becoming a new being. One, through generations, to within the artist herself or himself. So the composition is not a fixed element that is being parroted every time by the artist because the rules have been said it has to be sung. Structurally, in the Carnatic tradition, the composition itself is imbued with the idea of the creative spirit. Now there is something called a sangati. In this composition, first line melody, Ramanannu Bhruvaraya, Ramanannu Bhruvaraya, Ramanannu Bhruvaraya. Second, Ramanannu Bhruvaraya. This was not something I created now. This was handed over to me by my guru. The second variation was Ramanannu Bhruvaraya. Third,
Ramananu Brovara.
Fourth.
Ramananu Brovara.
Now, why is this happening? This is the spirit of imagination that is being passed on to every musician. It is not a rule book that has been given to you. It is telling you, listen to that first line and you will hear so much more like this. Every sangati or the movement comes from the bass line.
Ramananu Brovara.
That's the bass line.
Ramananu Brovara. Ramananu Brovara. Ramananu Brovara.
So what is being given to you is already a possibility. And I'll tell you that between different gurus, between different sampradayas, these don't remain the same. So even there is that variance. There is no one version of this song. There can never be. So this is the way I was given it and I have interpreted it, of course. Then there is a different school that will have a different set. Another school that will have another set. So I'll give you a little anecdote here. So there's a very popular Carnatic music composition of Tyagaraja called Orangasai. I'll just sing the first line. Raga is Kamboji.
Oh, Rangasai.
Notice the difference between the first line and what I sang now. The movement was. This goes on. There are about seven variations. The anecdote is this. This version that you're hearing now, which you will get on YouTube. This is the only version you hear on YouTube, by the way, practically. Was a version set in place. When I say set, I mean the structure of this development of melody by my guru, Samaguri Srinivasaya. Now, before my guru set this up like this, there was a very set version sung by another great artist called Musiri Subramaniyaya. And the anecdote, the folklore, is that after Samaguri had done his version of it and it became supremely popular, everybody only knows this, he apparently went to Musiri and asked him, so what did you think of this? So he said, not bad. What I'm trying to say is, this is not something that's happened 200 years ago. So if anybody here thinks I'm singing anywhere close to what Tyagaraja or Dikshitar sang, we are fooling ourselves. Tyagaraja and Dikshitar gave us the possibility entrenched in the sound and the movement and in the rhythm. And that has been moved by so many human beings. That's the human endeavor, isn't it? The human endeavor is the fact that it doesn't remain. Human beings are part of the endeavor. Tyagaraja is alive not because of Tyagaraja. He's alive because of all of us. And that's the human endeavor. And therefore, even this is not static. So is the composition really static? You can see the complexity in that question. Now, so when anybody listens to a kirtana, don't think this is something that musicians in Carnatic music all parrot. We don't. I can play the same composition sung by the same artist on four different days and I can tell you that loop was not there, this cut was not there, this frame was not there. It always happens. So the composition itself is a point of inspiration, point of creativity, point of generational change and point of maturity of the individual handling the kirtana itself. So even before I get into the mechanisms of improv, or what you want to call it, there is this right here when I sing a composition. So we learn, by the way, all the ideas of raga for us comes from compositions, very much like bandishes. If you ask any serious Hindustani musician, they will tell you that they learn the raga actually from the various bandishes. Similarly, we learn the raga because of the compositions. So if I want to understand the raga Kamboji, I learned so many compositions in Kamboji. Each composition gives me a different facet, a different angle, a different window, a different address sometimes. And that is all that is there in my body and my thinking and my spirit and my emotion. When I think of, say, using some openings to find something. Another thing I will tell you about the notion of slowness. Octave also plays a role in the notion of slowness. A person who has a very deep baritone or sings at the lower octave a lot is sensed to be slower. Whereas if your person is rushing up on a higher decibel and a frequency and a pitch level, it seems to be faster. And that is also another problem in a kirtana. The kirtana in its form looks at all octaves. So the song I sang, Ramananu Brovara, Ramananu Brovara, Ramananu, this is mid. And as the variations which I was handed down to me, which called Sangatis, come in, we were Rama, still higher, Rama, higher. So as because the form itself is like this, it almost feels like, why is this person rushing? We are not rushing. It's the it's how we absorb sound is very fascinating. As the octave increases, we think that it's faster. We think it's louder. If I had sung, one, you'll think I'm more sensitive, which may be rubbish. That's the other thing, right? You sing softly and everybody says we are sensitive. I mean, there can be very insensitive soft music. As the form itself starts investigating, say, the higher octave immediately, there is a feeling that it is being rushed. Then the first part of the composition known as a Pallavi. The second part is called Anupallavi. And in a composition which is usually in the Tyagaraja plan, he intentionally hits the upper octave. The second part of this composition, Simalo, Brahmalo, Simalo, Brahmalo, Simalo, Brahmalo, Simalo, Brahmalo, Sivakesa. Can you see what happens to the sound? So, this is a form. What you have to understand, this is the form. And the third part, Charana, takes all octaves. Now there's another thing which I hinted in the beginning is the role of these two people. The role of the mridanga or the ghata is not equivalent to the role of the tabla. They are two different frameworks. Therefore, their accusations against tabla players is rubbish. Tabla players' accusations on them is equally rubbish. Because both of them are looking at each other from frames that don't associate with each other. So there is no this unified idea of Indian classical music. We are not unified. And I think that's something we need to learn to respect, celebrate, and actually be in wonderment. Not think that this is all come. And also historically, anybody told you there was one Indian classical music that split into two, Hindustani and Carnatic, because the Mughals invaded India? Don't believe it. It is absolutely historically, aesthetically, musicologically wrong. It's just wrong. There's no other word to use it. It is wrong, and I'm happy to debate this anywhere. Because the complexity of traditions evolving is far more dynamic and something that we should get goosebumps about. Just thinking about how art has moved, sound has moved, is something that we should be, my goodness, how did this happen? So it's not a linear one line that became two and then became four. It's not a family tree we are drawing here. So that also kept aside. So another thing, one of the important roles that the tabla is doing, so the whole notion of the sum. Now the sum is like the highlight point in khayal especially, right? So everybody coming back and self-music in congruence, finding that sum is where everybody goes, aha. That's the aha that keeps the bandish together. So coming back to the sum is also the aha where the liberties taken are then brought back to framework and said, this is where we're joining back. So the tabla player is also playing a role of constantly bringing that back. So the structure of the tala is actually structurally maintained by the tabla. Here, they are not doing that at all. Their job is not to maintain structure. I am doing this for myself. Like in Drupadiya, they actually keep tala. So there's some similarity there. So, I don't need him to tell me where the sum is. One is we don't necessarily keep highlighting the sum. That's not in the Carnatic tradition. That's a larger discussion we have to have. I'm not going there now. Two is they don't need to give me this. So what are they doing? They are trying to say, okay, let's look at the different layerings. There is a framework. Okay, this is a framework. There is a pause between the frameworks. And it's in the relationship of the, what you call the event, which is the beat. And the interval in between is where this framework is established, right? On this, what am I layering?
Ramananu Brovara.
I've layered a melodic line. I have accentuated parts of that melodic line with syllables. Let's talk to them of syllables now. Ramananu Brovara.
Ramananu.
What is the syllables doing? They are framing the points in the raga where you could have that accent. The syllables are not arbitrarily placed. They are placed so that that raga frame is established. That immediately you know that in this raga, ga is important.
Ra, ramananu, bro, va, ra.
Where ra is all a design. It's not accent, accident. So in this framework, you have a melody line layered with syllables, which is framing a syllabic possibility, a melodic possibility, accentuated points, and all within this frame. Now, what is his job? Say, let's get one more layer going above that or below that. That's what they're doing. So I want you to now, I want them to first just play the beat. Okay? And when I signal, he'll be layering it. And I want you to experientially, don't look at what they are doing. Just listen to see how it sounds different. Tattamatavashi.
Ramananu Brovara. Ramananu Brovara.
See the difference that they are actually adding a layer of sound through rhythm with a sense of all this. They can't at any point destroy the composition structure. They can't destroy the raga sound. They can't destroy the mood I'm creating. So this is functionally different. If they played like this for a bandish, it's ridiculous, because in the bandish, there is a different kind of circularity which they have to follow. Here is a different kind of circularity that they are following. So why I'm showing you all this, that just the presentation of a composition is itself Manodharma. We just sang a composition. I've not even gone into Alap. All this is Manodharma. In how we respond to each other is Manodharma. If I sing this composition now, he's going to play differently. Matriya, where am I going?
Ramananu Brovara. Ramananu Brovara. Ramananu Brovara. Vemakolo Kavira.
Now you felt like there was some, right? Finally, so that's the effect. So you can see that there is something else happening here. We don't need to understand the technicalities, but we need to recognize the difference in the way we listen.